Welcome to this week's edition of An Organic Conversation, a show about food, ecology, stories from the land, recipes, nature, sustainability, interconnectedness, relationships, and life itself. Happy Halloween here from the TalkStream Network studios in San Francisco. This is the week to gear up for it, to get your costume ready if you'd like to dress up, or at least get your treats ready, whether you will hand those out or eat some of them yourself. It's a week of candy for many of us, often regardless of age, and we are dedicating this hour to help you find the healthiest options for trick or treaters. And Mark, this does not mean avocado pudding. No, we're talking real chocolate and other real chocolatey Halloween treats. Conscientious candy, tips for a healthier Halloween, our topic today here on An Organic Conversation. We're your hosts, Helga Hilberg,
Mark Mulcahy,
and Sita Rani Palomar. Yes, avocado pudding. That does sound delicious, but not necessarily something you'd want to give to the kids.
Hard to hand out anyway.
It is hard to hand out, yeah. Well, speaking of buying... Oh, you have...
No, I was just going to say we could change how we go about things in society, right?
We could.
An avocado could be the treat of treats if we really were on our game.
Yeah, couple years.
Well, we'll cover that and more before we jump into that. Speaking of buying the best, an interesting thing came up in the news recently. There was a piece about expiration dates and what goes into determining what the expiration date is of a food item. And in some cases, it's marketing. And it's not actually the date when the food, quote unquote, spoils. So this is really fascinating to me because we're looking at a country that has a tremendous amount of food waste. And we're relying on a printed date on a piece of food to tell us whether or not we should buy this or throw this out or eat this. And to me, it just goes back. And I'm not saying that all of it is marketing.
Sure.
I think there are definitely good reasons for expiration dates. But I think that in light of this new bit of news, it's important for us to remember to use our senses. Trust your instinct or the scent or the look of it. I mean, you should be able to tell when food has spoiled or when it hasn't, even if the expiration date said to throw it out a couple days ago. I mean,
so Kristen, it's not a requirement or something you can legally trust.
Oh, tricky!
Just something you can legally trust. Well, here's the deal: is like I think we look at all these bits of information because they're sell by date. There's expiration date, enjoy by date,
right? Oh, yeah.
And yet,
societally,
or when us as shoppers, we look at all those things and we refer to them in the exact same manner. It's like, oh, it's the expiration date. I got to get rid of it. Oh, sell by date. I need to get, you know, not use this anymore. And the reality is none of them are really tied. It became a marketing thing. Yes, there are times when things are bad, but most things you read, you find out about dairy, that dairy is still, if it's kept under proper temperatures, is still good well beyond the expiration date. Mm. Whereas in produce sometimes, like on a salad, you know, a packet salad, it'll say sell by date, right? Those types of things. And in those things, the reality is we just have to decide, as you were saying, Sita, is trusting your instincts, using your eyes and your nose. And most produce items, the interesting thing for me is, again, most produce items do not have a sell-by date. A packaged salad might, but if you go around your produce department, your mango doesn't have a sell-by date, your apple doesn't have a sell-by date, because it's the most awesome food!
But even, you're right, Mark. Even with a salad, if it's a sell-by Wednesday, whatever that date is, and you buy it, you need to decide at home how you brought it home, how quickly you brought it home, how well you stored it, how well your fridge works, you know, all that. So... Mm-hmm. Yeah, not a guarantee. I like enjoy by a lot. That's just so funny. It seems so personal. You enjoy that by tonight, okay? With your partner. It's like enjoy by, yes, but even that exists. In all cases, it's not a guarantee. I've eaten food where it was still 4 days before expiration date, and that was food that was only good for a week anyway, like a, you know, pre-made sandwich or something, and it was not good anymore. So what you're saying, you know, really trust your instinct. The label is an indication, but it really doesn't mean it's guaranteed fresh, and also it doesn't mean it's guaranteed expired when it actually says it is expired or that it's
Because the opposite is true, too. When we were talking about this in pre-production, what our associate producer, Kristen Ponger, was saying is that she and her partner have noticed that their milk lasts many days past the date that they said you should throw it out. It hasn't spoiled yet. So they're not going to toss away the rest of it if it's still good. And I think that the point you bring up, Mark, about there aren't expiration dates on fresh produce items, we are already using those visual cues to or the scent cues.
Yeah,
like, this
senses.
Smells fermented. I didn't eat this piece of fruit early enough, or it's too soft. We can
Looks
use
rotten,
those same
tastes
tools.
Rotten. Oh, it's rotten. Or it looks fresh, it smells fresh. I love that. Can you try that? I think it's bad.
Yeah.
Helen, you're the king of that, so you know. Okay.
You're the person I love. Would you try this stuff?
Thank you. You're listening to An Organic Conversation. I'm Helge Hellberg.
I'm Mark Mulcahy.
And I'm C.T. Ronnie Palomar.
We're talking about Halloween. What else? In this week's episode, Conscientious Candy, Tips for a Healthier Halloween, a yummy hour for slightly better alternatives to hand out and perhaps sneak for yourself. But before we dive into the topic fully, as always, here's our weekly tip from the world of health and beauty. Here's Chef Sita and her holistic bite.
Well, this week I want to talk about pumpkins. It's really timely. The great Halloween pumpkin, the Thanksgiving pumpkin, the Christmas pumpkin. I mean, we're going to put it in just about everything now. We're going to spice it up. We're going to puree it. It is such a fruit of the times. And interestingly, we've seen that pumpkins have played kind of a historical, magical role in our society. We see them in Cinderella, the pumpkin that turns into the carriage. They also are jack-o'-lanterns, which traditionally meant they would ward off evil spirits. But in addition to these mystical properties, they also have medicinal properties. And this is something that's been used by cultures all around the world. Mm. One thing that comes up when you talk about pumpkins and a lot of other hard winter squashes is that they're really rich in beta carotene and all of the carotenoids, that class of phytonutrients. And the way you know is because of its color. I've talked about this on the show before, that the phytonutrient you can identify has to do with the color, and that yellow orange is a carotenoid or a carotene. So that is really great for protecting your eye health. It prevents what's called macular degeneration. And then also, pumpkins are really great for blood sugar. They found some research that says pumpkins in particular are protective against type 2 diabetes. And pumpkins are great at helping to preserve prostate health. So fantastic for you. Also incredibly delicious. So the magic thing about working with pumpkins or any other winter squash is if you roast it, you want to do 350 degrees for about 45 minutes. If you want to caramelize it, you will go up to 375. And there's some wiggle room there depending on how big it is or how you cut it or how you want to use it. But that's one thing that people always worry about because it may not get cooked through all the way. 350 degrees for about 45 minutes. And, you know, when you make a pumpkin pie, if you are going to use pumpkin, then going with a smaller pumpkin, like a sugar pie pumpkin, I think that's what they call it, right, Mark? Sugar pie pumpkin is great because it's sweeter. The flavor is going to be better because it's smaller. Also, a lot of people may not realize, but you can use other squashes than pumpkin to make your pumpkin pie. Delicata makes a great pumpkin pie. I've even use butternut squash to make pumpkin pie, and part of what gives it that classic flavor is the combination of the spices. So you can fudge it a little bit if you have a different type of squash in the house or a different type of squash that you know how to work with. Other things you can do, you can use your acorn squash. I love this. Cut it in half. You've got your two halves. Top it with some coconut oil, maple syrup, a little bit of cinnamon, and some sea salt, and roast it in the oven like that whole. And all of those flavors get down through the flesh, and then you can just eat it with a spoon. You can use spaghetti squash and saute it up with some fennel and some leeks and a little bit of olives, or kabocha, which is really great, just sliced in those beautiful C shapes and then pan fried. So just a couple things to get you started to enjoy the summer or the winter squash this season, and particularly pumpkin, which is so good for your health. And that's that for this week's Holistic Bite.
Thank you, Sita. That's Chef Sita. How do you caramelize? You just threw that in. I'm like, I always caramelize onions, pumpkin.
Good.
How do you caramelize onions?
Well, really, pumpkins? It has to do with how long the sugars cook, because there are natural sugars in onions, in your example, and then also in these winter squashes. So the higher the temperature and the longer it cooks, the better chance you get of caramelizing the sugars
onions,
that are already in the fruit or
vegetable.
I have
that down, but I've never even heard of caramelizing pumpkins.
Well,
what does that
for
mean?
Example, if you were to cube your butternut squash and steam it, you're not going to end up caramelizing the sugars because it's not going to get hot enough to. But if you cube it and you put it in a 375 degree oven and you let it cook for longer, you'll see it'll start to get a little bit brown on the outside. And that is when the sugars start to caramelize. And then if you were to puree butternut squash that you steamed and puree butternut squash that you roasted and got a little bit
different
more
flavor.
Of that, totally different flavor.
This is your song, huh?
I love that. I mean, I could sit here and listen to her talk about squash all day long. It's not a problem, or pumpkins all day long. You know, the interesting thing when I was listening, two things came up for me. One is we talked about jack-o'-lantern. I mean, you brought in pumpkins, and they were used as jack-o'-lanterns. You know what they used to? They used to do turnips. They used to carve turnips. Can you imagine taking this 30-pound turnip and trying to carve that as a jack-o'-lantern to ward off evil spirits?
I can't.
I tell you what,
imagine.
That would be some major work. That's solid all the way through.
That is so dense.
Right? So that used to be the way that they would do that. Another quick tip on this is you're doing your jack-o'-lantern, you're making some pumpkin pie or anything out of that. What do you do with the seeds?
Uh-huh.
Right? And Sita will always have great recipes for doing that. But what everybody does is you got this hand blob of seeds and fleshy, stringy stuff. You just put that in a bowl of warm water and then move your fingers around, and then the seeds will come loose. And then that's an easy way if you want to roast your seeds or something like that.
Do they start floating, or do they sink to the bottom, or how do you sift
it? They will actually float.
Yeah? Nice. Yeah, I love that. It's amazing that you can buy a little bag of pumpkin seeds with salt for whatever it is, $1.99 or 99 cents. But this is actually the stuff we throw away. There's no difference.
It usually ends up in the compost.
They don't grow pumpkin seeds.
Right.
They use the pumpkin seeds from a pumpkin to roast them, as you said, 350, 45 minutes, and a little bit of salt when they're still wet, so the salt sticks. Oh, delicious.
Well, and with the seeds, it's not 45 minutes for the seeds. It's 45 minutes for the pumpkin itself. But for the seeds, it's only about 15 minutes.
Seeds.
Well,
yes.
They're higher in oil,
quick.
And you don't want to
Okay, seeds, 350 degrees, 15 minutes.
Exactly, about 15 minutes. You're really going to look for color. You want them to get golden brown. And it's not just pumpkin. You can use the seeds from butternut squash, spaghetti squash.
That's the thing that's not done, I think, as often as they would with we do with pumpkin seeds. We just take those seeds out of a butternut or out of a Hubbard squash or something, and you can use them the exact same way.
Delicious.
Fun. You're listening to An Organic Conversation. I'm Helga Hellberg.
I'm Mark Mulcahy.
And I'm Sita Rani Palomar.
Our topic today in this hour is conscientious candy. Yep, conscientious candy. Tips for a healthier Halloween. That and more when we come back right after the break. Stay tuned.
Are you a chef, have a catering business, or planning a party, or simply just love organic produce? If you're in the San Francisco Bay Area, walk right in to Earl's Organic Produce. Anyone can buy directly from us at wholesale prices. You don't have to be a natural food store to enjoy the freshest and most delicious organic produce. We are located on the San Francisco Produce Market at 21 Gerald Avenue. We look forward to seeing you.
Walk-in hours are Monday through Friday throughout the night from 10 p.m. to 10 a.m. Minimum purchase is one box or flat, cash or checks only. For more information, visit earlsorganic.com.
Fry Vineyards is America's first organic winery, family-owned and operated since 1980. Dedicated to the highest levels of organic and biodynamic farming, Fry never adds synthetic sulfites or other preservatives to their wines. Fry organic and biodynamic wines include delicious Cabernet Sauvignon, Zinfandel, Syrah, Chardonnay, and Sauvignon Blanc. Fry Vineyards Mendocino County award-winning wines without added sulfites. Available at grocery stores and online at frywine.com. That's FREYWINE.com.
You're listening to An Organic Conversation.
I'm Helga Hellberg.
I'm Mark Mulcahy.
And I'm Sita Rani Palomar.
And we are talking about Halloween in this hour. What else? Conscientious candy. Tips for a healthier Halloween. A yummy hour for slightly better alternatives to hand out or sneak for yourself. Mm-hmm. And Mark, you did some research on the origins of Halloween.
I did. It was pretty interesting. It goes back to Celtic times. And on October 31st, they celebrated a holiday called Samhain. And basically what they believe that is on October 31st is that it was the one day of the year that the two worlds, the worlds of the dead and the worlds of the living, overlapped. And with that, that meant the dead could walk the earth. And so what they would do is they'd create these elaborate bonfires, right, which drew insects, and then that drew bats, and that's how bats got associated with Halloween. Oh. And they would also put on masks to either appease, kind of like, okay, I'm one of you with the dead, right? You know, don't bother me, I'm one of you, or to try to scare away the dead. So that's where the mask came in. So both of those things were kind of all tied into Halloween. The thing about trick-or-treating as we know it also goes back to the Middle Ages, where people on November 1st, which is also known as All Souls Day, would go around to houses and they would say, we will pray for your dead. It was called souling, and we will pray for your dead if you give us food or treats. And so then that transpired into the more modern thing of trick-or-treating.
Wow.
So very interesting stuff on how all this stuff comes about. And
it's not all Hollywood. It's not all, you know, the bats. There's real historic roots in this.
And not all countries, celebrate Halloween. You didn't grow up celebrating Halloween, right?
Yeah, no. In Germany, there's nothing even like it. Even though having some pagan roots in that holiday, of course, or the origin rooted there, which would be more Britain, but you know, very much embraced and rooted in Germany too. We never had Halloween. It's an unknown holiday. And now, because Germany is very close with American culture, and there are lots of small towns where kids, you know, get excited about dressing up now. But I don't think it's not coming from that traditional historic, you know, origin that you just spoke. It's just adopted from the American tradition now. So you go around, get trick and treat, and dress up like a cowboy, and that's pretty much it. But interesting roots.
I am fascinated by that story. That is really great information. I love that people used to go and pray for one another, and that's how people would in kind say thank you so much for praying for my ancestors, and here's a little treat. So,
and now, usually have it been food. Now it's really almost entirely candy, and it's, of course, mostly kids.
Well, when I was growing up, actually, it wasn't uncommon that someone would put an apple in your bag, and you thought, oh, who would give me an apple? I want candy, right? But the
not you.
But No. That let started my produce career.
Bar.
Oh, what is this? Yeah. Is this a Macintosh or a Cortland one?
Yes, right. Did you pick that?
This is about
north?
A week too far gone. Yeah, you know, I
right. I'll come back next year. Yeah. Better get this
so
right.
Funny. That is a really interesting point, because I remember when I was young and I was trick-or-treating, this was about the time where they started discouraging people from giving out fruit, because the concern was you don't know if somebody has put something
you
in
couldn't
that.
Trust somebody.
Yeah, which is unfortunate, but I also really respect a parent's right to say, I want to make sure that this is packaged and hasn't been tampered with. So that's where today's show comes in, because so much of the candy industry, I mean, there are lots of things about this that I think we're giving it in mass quantity to children. Yes, it's only once a year, and I believe in indulgence, but the ingredients are bad for your health in a lot of cases. The processes are bad for your health. They're bad for the environment. They're bad for the people who create
them. What are
we
talking about? Like, do you have some examples of what's in a standard candy? No brand names mentioned here on the show, but
okay.
What would you face if you went into a normal supermarket, not health food store, and you know, what would one find?
So the top things that I keep an eye out for that are in most commercial candies are bad fats and bad sugars.
Hydrogenated fats
I think are just about the worst offenders out there. I mean, these are fats that have been manipulated so that you could get a certain texture and a certain shelf life out of it. And what happens is that they're foreign in the body. They change the way they break down from a normal fat, and in some cases, I think in most cases, hydrogenated fats have been linked to carcinogens in the body later on. They help to create free radicals, and free radicals can mutate your cells and potentially become cancer. So hydrogenated oils go into a lot of chocolates and candies and fillings.
It's really surprising.
Yeah.
When I go to the airports and occasionally I just want to like a little piece. I usually carry my own chocolate, as you very well know. But occasionally, and then I'll go look and I'll look at what I think is a really good brand. Like, you know, you think, oh, this is a quality brand, so I'm going to grab that and I turn it over and it's like,
What
first ingredient, right?
Why is this in here? It really surprises me. Yeah.
And then also on the sugar side, you see a lot of high fructose corn syrup.
Sure.
And the way that impacts your blood sugar is so dramatic. I mean, it's they're seeing so many relationships between insulin
regular
resistance.
Sugar.
Yeah, it is really hard on your system. That's for sure.
And one of the things that's happening is as they switch from hydrogenated oil, because there is a mandate to move food products
away from
hydrogenated oil in trans fats, is they're going to palm.
Yes.
Because it's supposedly cheap.
And we had an entire show on palm oil production.
We did.
The
that
devastating
was a great
effect
episode.
On the environment.
Originally aired in March of 2012. It's called Youth Activists. Mm-hmm. And what we learned from these two brilliant young women, they're about 13 now, I think, or maybe 16 now.
Yeah, they're in high school.
They're in high school now. But what they did was for their Girl Scout project when they were younger, it had to be a social service project. And they were looking at the ingredients that were in their Girl Scout cookies, which was largely palm oil,
mm-hmm.
and looking at, they happen to love orangutans. And the orangutan habitat is in the palm trees. And all of these forests mm-hmm. that were the natural
Great
habitat
episode.
For them were being cut down to create really cheap oil for the cookies and for the candy, which we're talking about today. So mm-hmm. so that's part of the ethical and the environmental side of the danger of buying cheap candy.
When did that show aired again?
March of 2012.
Yeah, check
Youth
it
Activists.
Out. And organicconversation.com, of course, for all of our shows. And you can also follow us on Facebook. That's facebook.com/anorganicconversation. I got it right this
you
time.
You did. Nice job.
Practice perfect.
And also, if you want to see Mark's produce shirts, we are now streaming a video podcast on talkstreamnetwork.com. We are speaking about conscientious candy in this hour, tips for a healthier Halloween. I'm just looking at the personal health effects on high fructose corn syrup and hydrogenated oils in most conventional candy. Of course, that translates into a whole backstory of environmental degradation
yes.
and cultural and social impact. Of course, we know hydrogenated oils and high fructose corn syrup, corn, GMOs, genetic mm-hmm. engineered ingredients. There's corporate interests, cacao, how that is harvested, the impact on the rainforest, wages. None of that is done in a fair way or reimbursed through a fair trade agreement, as we would describe the exchange of culture and products fairly. So when you buy that bag of chocolate, and right now I think they offer Halloween bags that are like six times the
mm-hmm,
size,
mm-hmm.
if you really look at the impact of that and the price, we are talking, a couple dollars, and a couple dollars difference or more to much healthier alternatives actually for yourself, even if it's still sugar-based, but much better because of the quality of sugar and the oils and, of course, the corporate interests, that whole world of environmental impacts and social impacts in addition to that.
Well, that's something I really love about your stance on this, Helga, and I've heard you say this many, many times in the past, and that is the true cost of production, right? You really get what you pay for. Yes,
right.
You can buy cheap candy, and that may reflect positively on your pocketbook right now, but the ripple effects of what gets sacrificed because of that cheap candy is kind of endless.
And Mark is really our flavor master. I mean, even the flavor, when you buy something where the ingredients are good, whether it's a psychological aspect or it's really just tastier, there are so many delicious, really, I don't want to say healthy options, but healthier options in candy out there that are just wonderful, really, really tasty, beautiful alternatives, and we want to talk about those when we come back.
Mm-hmm.
You're listening to An Organic Conversation. I'm Helga Hilder.
I'm Mark Mulcahy.
And I'm Sita Rani Palomar.
We're talking about conscientious candy, tips for a healthier Halloween in this yummy hour. That and more when we come back right after the break. Stay tuned.
Are you interested in making healthy food your profession? Bowman College is a leader in the field of holistic nutrition and culinary arts. Their professional training programs prepare individuals for successful careers as nutrition consultants and natural chefs. Study at one of four locations in California and Colorado, or learn from home in a self-paced mentor distance learning program. Find out more about their classes on holistic nutrition and culinary arts at bowmancollege.org. That's B-A-U-M-A-N college.org.
NextSpace brings together a professional, collaborative workspace with a warm, supportive community. It's a place where you can do your very best work. And now, NextSpace is introducing NextKids, a workspace that also provides great on-site child play care. Hi, I'm Diana Rothschild, founder and chief mom of NextKids. We believe that you can be a better parent and produce better work when you seamlessly integrate work and life. We're better together. Join this conversation at nextkids.us.
You're listening to an organic conversation.
I'm Helge Helberg.
I'm Mark Mulcahy.
And I'm Sitarani Palomar.
And we are dedicating an hour to conscientious candy as we are celebrating Halloween. Tips for a healthier Halloween. Healthier Halloween. A yummy hour. We just talked about the health impacts of most treats and chocolates out there if they don't have the health of the environment or the health of the consumer in mind. What are some of those alternatives? We talked in the beginning that giving produce, which Mark would do, is kind of taboo. So we are looking at produce alternatives. I'm sorry, Mark.
I know this is even I love fair trade chocolate. You know, and before I go in here, I went and did a little comparison shopping before the show. And I wanted to just see, okay, if I go into a natural food store and, you know, what are they going for a bag? Because they have bags of chocolate or fair trade chocolate or good oil chocolate, you know, as well. You're going to see that on an end cap, too. It's either way. And I went into just a standard, like, drugstore and looked at their end caps. And now the sizing is different.
What's an end cap?
An end cap is that thing you walk into at the end of a grocery aisle that tries to get you to buy something that you weren't planning on buying.
So like a little special display of
any store does it. Great question. And I found that one bag for like at a natural food store was like $6.99 for the bag. And at the drugstore, it was $4.79. Now there was more in the $4.79 bag. There was more quantity, but giving out, you could do either for about $2 more, $2 and and that's pretty decent, right?
And then so the impact for $2, what do you get?
Well, and this is an interesting idea because I remember this from years and years, not just of trick or treating, but also of giving out candy. One, you always have way more candy than you need.
Always.
Always.
And two.
And you always sit on candy. I mean, you're hoping, you like, you know, I don't know.
And
how
it
messes
up your pants when you do that.
How many kids are coming? Like 8, 10, maybe 20? But I mean, I've never heard of anyone really running out of candy. And if they did, good for them.
Then
they
you
had
got
a
eggs
lot
on
of people.
House.
No, then
oh,
you
I mean,
know. Then you know exactly.
Well,
then your car
as adults, we don't want any. Usually, we don't want much candy left over at the end. So we get to a point where we're like, "Wow, it's kind of a slow Halloween. Maybe it's the weather. I'm going to start giving a handful of candy at a time."
Bam-o.
So
yeah.
That's
or
why when
maybe
you
it
get
was
the
me yelling at kids kicking their football over every year. We had a no.
It's the reason that they don't have Halloween in Germany.
It's a completely different.
But let's definitely talk about what makes the quality chocolates better.
Okay.
Or the quality candies better.
So a thing for me is I buy fair trade chocolate. I always have these little bars in my backpack, as you know, which because of meetings, usually about 2 o'clock in the afternoon.
Yes, he does.
We all get chocolate.
And the fair trade thing is a big thing for me because that means the people who are producing the product actually are paid a decent wage, a fair price for the product they're producing, and it makes a huge difference in the livelihood of those workers every day.
Yes, what it actually translates into is education for their kids. I mean, we are talking
water,
sometimes
if
penny,
skills,
right?
So that
one
they can
penny
keep running
or two
their
pennies per pound or whatever product we are talking about, but per unit, one or two pennies, and that actually at the end of the month
healthcare could be.
Exactly.
Right.
Makes the difference in education, healthcare, and everything. And so when you translate that forward and we pay, you know, 10 cents more, 40 cents more, it means that there's an entire culture, an entire community decently off. Right?
Better
well
supported.
Off. Yeah, exactly. Mm-hmm. Better supported. So, yeah, fair trade, great
thing to
look for.
That's a big thing
for
me.
Especially for chocolate, right?
Especially for chocolate, yeah.
So that's one place where the price may be a little bit higher because you're actually paying for somebody to have better quality of life.
Really
no
important.
No brainer for me, obviously. Yes. There are other things, too, though.
And it's verified. People, you know, there are 50 labels out there, and people sometimes get confused, as I do, trying to navigate this world of claims and labels. Fair trade, something really great to look for, and it's verified and checked up on annually, and a really robust certification system.
And something else along the line of chocolate. And this is something that I discovered from a company called Alter Eco, which is a fair trade company that that blew my mind when I understood this.
Who we've had on the show.
We have had him on the show. Oh, that's right.
Eduardo Rolle. Yes.
Yeah, fantastic.
With his French accent. Wonderful show. Amazing. We were all in love after about 40 seconds.
He does have that restraining order, by the way.
So something about Alter Eco's chocolate. They taught me, they don't use any soy lecithin in their chocolate. And you will see most chocolates have soy lecithin as an ingredient. The reason they do that is because it helps to emulsify. Because when you get the chocolate, you end up having the cocoa mass and the cocoa butter. And you have to emulsify these two ingredients that wouldn't otherwise mix. And I've talked about this when we make vinaigrettes.
Yes.
So you use an emulsifying agent to help those two ingredients fuse together. That's the soy lecithin. We talked about GMO. We talked about soy as a highly genetically modified ingredient. With a specific technique, this is something that Alter Eco does. And this is actually classic for making chocolate. If you make chocolate
that's
the traditional
how it was
way,
done. Exactly.
This is how it was
or
done before we started trying to cut
before.
Time, is the conching process. That's what they call it. That's where they emulsify the cocoa mass and the cocoa butter. And with Alter Eco, instead of saving time and only emulsifying it or conching it for a short period and then adding a soy lecithin emulsifier, they just conch it for longer. It's a Swiss process.
Like
it
much
means they
longer,
don't
right?
have
to. Wasn't
much
he saying
longer.
20 hours?
I think it's at least 12 hours. And most people will stop after about 6. I'm not totally positive on these numbers, but this is my understanding. Yeah. So
much
if you can find chocolate that doesn't have soy lecithin, you're cutting out an additive, you're probably cutting out something that's genetically modified. And the chocolate is every bit, if not better.
Oh, yeah, it's
every
much
bit
cleaner.
It's so delicious.
Mm-hmm. Product.
Mm-hmm. And ideally, you want to look for something that's about 65% cocoa or higher. Now, I love milk chocolate, too, and it's good to indulge in milk chocolate that doesn't have the same high cocoa content. But cocoa is really high in antioxidants.
And that's
and the
only reason I eat it.
Yeah.
That doesn't look honest.
For health reasons. You're listening to an Organic Conversation. I'm Helge Helder.
And I'm Sita Rani Palomar.
And it's not about produce. It's about chocolate this week.
Chocolate.
You're talking about Halloween, conscientious candy tips for healthy Halloween. So,
and other than just chocolate, let me just throw it out there because we've been talking
Absolutely.
A lot about chocolate. There are a lot of sugar-based candies. Mm-hmm. And we talked about corn syrup and how you want to avoid that in the first half of the show. But in regular sugar is often processed a handful, like 4+ times, and it's bleached, and they do so much to it. Unrefined cane sugar does not go through the extensive processing and bleaching processes that you would get with regular sugar. So when you can find like a sugar base, like a coconut toffee or a ginger chew or something, if you don't just want to give out chocolate, there are still sustainable options, better for your health, better for the environment.
Great point. Yes, we have been speaking heavily about chocolate, and that's really often where it's at. But there is peanut butter bars, and there's lots of other things that are candy. If we are talking about those ingredients, some of the bags almost don't have enough space to write on to list all the color blue, red, 4 and lake 7, and it's amazing how many ingredients are in there that are not food-based in any way, shape, or form, in non-organic ingredients. So as the last item to or labeled to mention, if you can, if it's fair trade and made really well, high quality chocolate or candies throughout, and if you can find organic candies, that would guarantee you that those synthetic ingredients are not allowed at any level of production.
Mm-hmm.
So,
mm-hmm.
And you're right, Mark, for a couple dollars more, this might be the year to invest that, especially if you hand those out or eat them yourself.
So if you're looking for a list of these candies that we are talking about as better alternatives, check out our Facebook page. We will have a list of brands that we feel really meet these standards, so you can make sure you're stocking up with things that are delicious for sure.
And
it
we tried them all.
So it was a tough day
yeah.
to try.
Yeah, it's a tough assignment.
Yes, that's facebook.com/inorganic conversation for a list of conscientious candy for this Halloween season. And as always, you can also follow us on inorganicconversation.com or now streaming at talkstreamnetwork.com. Conscientious candy tips for a healthier Halloween, that and more when we come back right after the break. Stay tuned.
And so is work. And just like any game, sometimes your team is in a slump. Maybe it's a new team. Maybe there's conflict. Maybe you're under pressure to keep up with your own success. Whatever it is time to get your game face on. The ultimate game of work combines game design with executive coaching to create high engagement workplaces. Boost your team's creativity and performance by designing the game you want to play and win together with the ultimate game of work. Enticed? Learn more at ultimategameofwork.com.
Are you a chef, have a catering business, or planning a party, or simply just love organic produce? If you're in the San Francisco Bay Area, walk right in to Earl's Organic Produce. Anyone can buy directly from us at wholesale prices. You don't have to be a natural food store to enjoy the freshest and most delicious organic produce. We are located on the San Francisco Produce Market at 2101 Gerald Avenue. We look forward to seeing you.
Walk-in hours are Monday through Friday throughout the night from 10 p.m. to 10 a.m. Minimum purchase is one box or flat, cash or checks only. For more information, visit earlsorganic.com.
You're listening to An Organic Conversation.
It's Helga Hellberg.
Mark Mulcahy.
And Sitarani Palomar.
We talked about Halloween in this hour. Conscientious candy, tips for a healthier Halloween, what to look out for in labels and products that you may buy, whether you give them out yourself or you eat them yourself.
Hopefully a little of both.
Yeah, hopefully a little of both. And what to look for instead. Again, there's a list that we will post on our Facebook page. That's facebook.com/inorganicconversation. And you can also follow us on inorganicconversation.com. Video streaming now on talkstreamnetwork.com. Sita, you had a couple of really clever additional ideas for Halloween of how to manage the amount of sugar and what to do.
Well, even as somebody who doesn't trick-or-treat anymore, I have a hard time
I saw you last year out there
on
your knees walking and saying, yeah.
I can still eat a ridiculous amount of candy.
What?
And I know that...
What?
You know, it... Getting creative with what you do before you go out trick-or-treating with your kids to help manage how much they eat while they're trick-or-treating and when they get home, and for the weeks and months that they have candy afterwards,
what are some
will make
of
a
those
big
tips?
Impact. One thing that I really love is have them divide their candy into two piles, the things that they just love and the things that they're kind of on the fence about, and then just keep the stuff you love. Then you're cutting it in half. Another thing you can do is you can tell them to only eat candy 3 times a day. You get to have a piece of candy 3 times a day, and it has to be with a meal.
So when Helga comes back to the show, we can keep this going. Yeah.
For those of you that
who
do
doesn't
not know
need
what's
any candy,
in the studio, Helga's playing with our.
Yeah, we have a little bit of a Halloween decoration here in the studio just to get the atmosphere going, and I was just attacked by the skull lamp.
So candelabra.
What is it called?
Candelabra.
Oh, my. So funny.
And I saw that opera.
Again, talkstreamnetwork.com if you want to see what we look like and what it looks like when I get attacked by a skull lamp. I love that. Have two piles, only keep what you love, which is a good metaphor. Rule for life itself, really.
Yeah, for
sure. As this whole show always is. I also like the workout part.
Oh, yeah.
And Mark, you have a tradition of not you working out, but you know somebody who does.
Well, I actually know a family who every year after Thanksgiving dinner, which they eat kind of early, like 4 o'clock, they all go for a long walk at Muir Woods. So, Helga, you were saying, wouldn't it be great if
wonderful.
The tradition was either during the day before you go trick-or-treating or the day after Halloween, you do
the
a family
morning.
Physical activity.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Soccer tournament, whatever, something fun, for everyone to get their spike out. Because after you have that much sugar, you also have the crash, usually.
You do, which is
so
why I say,
additional food, healthy.
Tell your children that they can have their candy after their meals, so that they've already, primed their body to better absorb that sugar.
Love
and
it.
I also think it's important to eat before you go out trick-or-treating.
Huge deal.
Huge deal.
Don't make that
have
your
a
only
good
meal.
Dinner, but have a big party and invite, your kids' friends over and cook sweets, cook treats in a healthy way, so that you kind of curb that desire for something sweet before they go out, so they're less likely to gorge themselves while they're walking.
Don't feed your kids something really spicy and then send them out, because they will eat twice as much sweet stuff to compensate for the spicy.
They will?
I've not heard that before.
I think that is an old German adage.
No, but don't you always compensate for the other? So like if you eat really hearty, spicy, heavy.
Well, it's usually
heavy,
salty. The more salty food you eat, the more sugary food you want.
Whatever.
Conscientious Candy, tips for a healthier Halloween. Again, check us out on facebook.com/organicconversation for a list of yummy treats that we would recommend that are fair trade, organic, and where you can find those. And Mark, switching completely back to avocado pudding.
And where we should be.
It's that time. Here's the overview from the world of health and the produce docs, Mark Mulcahy, and What's in Season.
It is time for What's in Season, and following Sita's lead, I thought we'd continue with pumpkins, which makes sense. And, of course, on the line, we have the voice of the San Francisco produce market, Earl Herrick, calling in from down in Monterey, down in Pumpkin Central for California. And, Earl, are you there?
Yeah, Mark, I can hear you. Not real well, but I can hear you.
Well, that's because you're so far away.
I guess so.
I'll pull the can closer to my ear.
Would you please?
So, Earl, it's pumpkin time. It's the time when everybody starts thinking about them. They probably sell more pumpkins than any other time of the year. Why don't you give us a little idea what's going on in the season?
Yeah, this is their yearly center stage right now. And, you know, a couple weeks ago, I took a drive down the coast. Actually, you know, right now I'm in the middle of it and driving down here. There were pumpkins everywhere, still out in the field, pumpkin patches, farm stands. I mean, literally, they're everywhere. And this has been a good year. It's the low moisture, no early rain, so there's no mold problem, so production is strong. And, you know, they're field grown. They're grown right out in the field. They're a squash. And there's pretty much two types you're going to grow. You're going to grow large ones that are more of a gourd with a strong exterior, you know, maybe an inch or so of a crust, if you will, which you carve. Those are for carving jack-o'-lanterns. Then you get the other pumpkin pies, if you will, that are grown with a very small seed cavity with a lot more meat, and those are obviously grown for pumpkin pie and eating. And most of the production now is really for processing. But there's a huge amount of fresh pumpkins that are really to be gotten right now, and there's all sorts of varieties. Have you guys been talking about any of the different colors that you see?
No, we pray tell, we've been waiting for you.
Well, you know, it's got to be a real kind of boutique-y heirloom, you know, little society where they're growers take a real specialty in growing either the biggest or the prettiest or the different colors. I can't even keep up with the different names, but you can go out and find almost any color pumpkin you want in almost any shape.
I love the Cinderella pumpkins. Isn't that what they're called, Mark?
Sitting right next to you.
Yes. They're these gorgeous, like pale, creamy peach color, and sometimes they come in a cream color. They're just they're so beautiful on your table. They make for a great decoration.
And so as you're talking, Earl and Sita, there are so many varieties out there. You can get them in blue. You can get them in green. You can get them in deep orange that are flat and really heavily ridged. You can get them in that kind of creamy color that you're talking about. And what you're talking about there, Sita, is that one that's kind of beige. It's really a really nice kind of, I'm going to say, beige color that's really heavily ribbed. That's also called a French cheese pumpkin or a fairy tale pumpkin.
Fairy tale.
And then also Helga we have in the studio today is a Cinderella pumpkin. And that that tends to be a larger pumpkin, deeper orange with a little bit of green to it, that you could actually imagine it being a carriage.
It's really light, too.
For Cinderella. Yeah, well, you've been working out. So, Earl, the one thing I want to ask you about is one thing that happens all the time this time of year is stores have to make a decision on whether to carry an organic jack-o'-lantern or to carry a conventional jack-o'-lantern. And so what about that out there?
Well, Well, you know, retailers have something to deal with that is real practical, and that is space. And also, what we're seeing most consumers, since a jack-o'-lantern is not going to be consumed, many of them, it's not as important whether or not it's organic. And so most of the retailers I deal with only have a very small little display of a couple jack-o'-lanterns. They have a larger display of sugar pies. So on the jack-o'-lantern side, less organic. You're going to find a little harder to find unless it's kind of a special order in a retailer. I recommend, especially right now, go out to a farm stand, take a little drive on a weekend or after work, go outside of out of town and pick up some jack-o'-lanterns. Now, what's pretty cool about pumpkins is that it is a native. It's one of the natives of America. It's an ancient vegetable. So, you know, it's a season right now. It's a good time to partake of a real ancient local piece of food.
That's awesome, Earl. Thank you. Enjoy the drive back up the coast. We really appreciate you going down there and checking it out for us.
Folly. Beautiful.
Absolutely.
Yes.
And as always, we appreciate Earl Herrick from Earl's Organic Produce in San Francisco being on, always giving us these reports. Earl, drive safe, and we'll have you on next week.
Absolutely. Great. I'll be looking forward.
Thank you, Earl.
Thanks, Earl.
Two quick things here is, when you go to pick up a jack-o'-lantern, you know I always say heavy for its size with produce. It's true of the jack-o'-lantern because it means more moisture. And secondly, don't grab it by the handle. You want to make sure that it has an intact stem, because that's where bacteria can get in and will break your pumpkin down quicker. Also, we always want to take them and we put them on the table as before we're going to carve them, or stick them out on our porch or out on a veranda or something. You want to keep them out of the direct sun if you're not going to carve them right away, because you want them to last. They need to be kind of stay cool,
keep them moisture
in a cool part of your house until you're ready to carve them, because otherwise they'll break down quicker. And lastly, that whole thing about the organic. Yes, you don't see a lot of organic jack-o'-lanterns out there because of the price difference. It's quite a bit different. But if you are going to eat the seeds, if you do plan on eating the flesh of your jack-o'-lantern, you really do want to make sure that you're getting an organic jack-o'-lantern, because pumpkins and winter squash are known as they take up organophosphates from the soil. And
they're sponges.
They're like a sponge. They heavily concentrate organophosphates in their flesh from the soil. And so if you are going to be eating any types of winter squash, pumpkins, those types of things, that is one place on the eating thing that you would want to make sure you consider organic.
Wow, yes, and of course it gets stored in the seeds and the flesh, very much so. So that's even the concentrated form. It's not sitting on the outside. Thanks, Mark.
Mm-hmm.
Thanks for that update. Yes,
such a good wet
pumpkins
season.
It is, and I can just picture late fall climate right now, Earl driving up, you know, with pumpkin patches everywhere. Ah, gorgeous. It's so funny.
It puts you in the mood for
fall,
it
does.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
Yes.
Well, speaking of being in the mood for things, I'm in the mood for a little inspiration, which means it must be time for Helga's Organic Moment.
Yes. My weekly review of what inspires me or what moved me or great work that other people do. And in the spirit of Halloween, of course, I have an animal story. It's not the cat on the shoulder of the wise woman, but there was this guy who walked through our town, and everyone knew him when I was a child because he had a parrot on his shoulder, a very big parrot. It really looked like a pirate ship parrot.
It was a parrot that he was there.
Yeah, like a full-grown, substantial bird. I didn't know the name of the guy or anything about him, didn't even know where he really lived, but everyone knew him as I knew him as the guy with the parrot. Now, having a parrot as a friend is not that unusual nowadays, some 40 years later, but that was a big deal for me. And I was reminded of the man and his parrot from my childhood at the wedding of some dear friends a couple weeks back, Rebecca and Jason. Big shout out to them. I got into a conversation with one of the wedding guests, and we talked about animal relationships, and I have no idea how this conversation came about, but he was saying that he used to have a gecko, and that gecko would kind of really get nervous and look for him every time he left the room. So when his girlfriend had the gecko on his arm, he would literally try to jump down to follow this man out the room. And I thought geckos are kind of you know, not able to have that kind of bond, especially with a human being. But I guess I was wrong. I heard other stories of people with relationships with spiders or fish or snakes. And I myself had a turtle when I was younger that would come if I whistled. I'm not even sure if turtles have ears. Mark, you would know that. But I swear, every time I entered the room and whistled, some 5 minutes later, really slowly, she would make her way over to me. And yes, I had some letters, and she knew that. But the point is that she knew. She knew who I was.
Yeah, she knew who had letters.
My point is, there seems to be no boundary to relationships. There's no boundary to love. There's this book of animal friends that I just adore. There's this cat, if you want to check it out. I think it's called Uncommon Friendships or something. Unlikely Friendships. There's this cat, and the best friend is a squirrel or a bird. There's a Labrador, and his best friend is a duck, and a tiger, whose best friend is a monkey. In this case, we are talking, you know, usually their food supply, genetically millions of years, this is what they eat, and it's their best friend. So there might not be a true logical or even genetic rhyme or reason to it, but the message for this Halloween, and as always for the year, is love can supersede anything. Lucky us. And that's my loving organic moment for this week.
It's touching.
What's there to say?
Well, I do believe that you can develop a bond with just about anything. I mean, not just animal species, but plants and all kinds of things. And I think that instead of underestimating the emotional intelligence that an animal might have, what would this world look like if we overestimated, if we assumed that we could have this kind of a relationship with a turtle or a gecko?
And they've proven that plants do better when your intention is love, when you're tending a garden.
Oh, yeah,
you know,
absolutely.
Actually, we've been noticing, we just watched this fantastic documentary about sacred lands, which we're going to have on an episode in another couple of weeks. But what I noticed as I was looking at the way all of these indigenous cultures approach their harvest and their planting, they sing when they plant seeds.
Oh, yeah,
that's
going
to be some happy seeds going in the ground.
Yeah, those potatoes in the Andes, that scene. Yeah, that is coming up in 2 weeks. But it is amazing when you look at those photos, and there's this, you know, I don't know what they weigh, 1,000, 1,500, 2,000-pound polar bear cuddling a wolf. I mean, it's just amazing how far that can go, how much we can create love beyond anything that any scientist would ever understand.
I think it's the most powerful force in the universe.
After produce.
Mm-hmm. No.
Well, and it creates peace, which we could use a lot more of that worldwide.
That is so true. Mm-hmm.
Well, that was this week's edition of An Organic Conversation. Thanks for listening.
Bye-bye now.
Bye-bye.